accept their views. In fact, many of us older folks may remember that many years ago there was a commercial by an investment firm which said, when E.F. Hutton speaks, people listen. Unfortunately, there are many people in this world not only listening, but believing those other voices because they do sound reasonable. And the real problem is that most, if not all, of those voices, in fact, even the loudest, are contrary to the one voice that really matters. And that voice is God's voice. And that's why it's important for us to listen to God's voice, no matter how reasonable those other voices may sound. Now, to be sure, we can hear God speaking to us audibly, but we do have his written word, the Bible. And from God's written word, we know that at times he did speak audibly to people, like Adam and Eve, and Noah, and Abraham, and Isaac, and Jacob, and Moses, and all of the prophets. And they passed on what he said to them to us. That's why we need God's written word, because there are lots of idolatrous religions out there in the world, false prophets and misguided teachers who are using their voices to lead people away from God. That is one reason he sent his only begotten Son into the world. John called him the Word of God made flesh, because he was the audible voice of the Father. That's why the author to the Hebrews wrote, long ago, and at many times, and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son. That is why this morning we're going to learn why we can trust Jesus' voice in spite of all those other voices that are clamoring around us for our attention. First of all, we can trust Jesus' voice because his voice has power. All the other voices in this world, contrary to God's will, promise that they can solve all of our problems, that they can meet all of our needs. But Jesus' voice has the only voice that has the power to do that, because Jesus is God incarnate. And Jesus proved that because immediately before our text in Mark this morning, the Holy Spirit drove Jesus out into the wilderness. And he drove him out there to be tempted by Satan, by Satan's voice. And Mark didn't record what those temptations were, but we know from Matthew and Luke that Satan tempted Jesus to misuse his power in order to satisfy his own physical desires and needs. The Holy Spirit, or the Satan, tempted Jesus to jump off that temple in order to test his Father's love for him and to save him. And Satan also tempted Jesus to worship him for worldly gain. But in each of those, Jesus replied, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. It is written, You shall not put the Lord your God to the test. And he also said, be gone, Satan, for it is written, you shall not worship the Lord, you shall worship only the Lord your God, and him only you shall serve. And Satan left him because he failed in his mission, even though he twisted the scriptures in order to get Jesus to sin, but he didn't. And that is why it's so important for us to stay in God's word, to read God's word, to know God's word, because any other voice in this world that interferes with that word or tries to lead us away from our Heavenly Father is satanic. Yes, it is satanic. And when Satan tempts us through those other voices, God's word reminds us that we have his word, so that just as Jesus did, we can say, whenever we're tempted, we can say, be gone, Satan. Be gone, Satan. You shall worship the Lord your God, and only him shall you serve. And Satan will leave us, but we know he'll come back. And we can say the very same thing over and over again, because we have the power of God's word, the power of Jesus over Satan and all those other voices. Second of all, we can trust Jesus' voice because it is authoritative. Now, John the Baptist went around preaching and telling people to repent because the kingdom of God had come. And they went out to him and they were baptized by him for the repentance of their sins. And one day when Jesus came by, John said, look, the Lamb of God that has come into this world, the Lamb of God who has come to take away the sins of the world. for faithfulness and urgency in the church. And as this world passes away, we may be bold to proclaim the kingdom of God come near in Christ Jesus, who does not desire the death of a sinner, but that all would repent and believe the gospel. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the church's mission, and as Christ called Peter and Andrew, James and John to follow him and made them fishers of men, he would send faithful preachers also in our time, especially to our congregations and other congregations without full-time pastors. And for those who generously support the missionaries, seminaries, colleges, and other institutions of our church, for the spread of the gospel and the service of God's people, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Christians in every home, that they may have constancy and contentment in their God-given stations, despite their current distress, as the present form of this world passes away. For the married, that God will give them comfort and faithfulness, strengthening them also to pass on the faith to the next generation. And for the unmarried, that assured of the holiness of their place in life, they would live free from anxiety and attend to holiness in body and spirit with undivided devotion to Christ. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our nation, with its rulers, that God would spare Joseph, our president, our legislatures, our governors, and all who serve for the good of this people, especially those who put themselves strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace.